morning, everybody. I got to the other side and realized I was on the wrong side, so I came across. Welcome to Fellowship of Faith. Hopefully you guys have you come and you feel welcome this morning. You've already felt the Spirit of God on this great Palm Sunday. For those of you who don't know necessarily exactly what Palm Sunday is, I'm going to talk a little bit about it a little bit later, but the idea of Christ entering Jerusalem the week before the crucifixion and resurrection and all of those things, it's the kind of the marks the beginning of that entire Holy Week. If it's your first time, we are really glad that you're here, and we are excited that you came to worship with us this morning. Hopefully, you've been welcomed by somebody, but maybe if you snuck in a little bit late, you probably met quite a few of our people as you were doing that. But also, hopefully you'll hang out a little bit afterwards to say hello. We also have a lunch every Sunday at Rio Grande afterward, or at Bob Evans and Rio Grande afterwards. If you want to come and have lunch with us there, that would be great. Also, there's a yellow card in the back of the chair, and I would like, if you would, take that and just fill it out. And there's a connection center out there. As you come in the door, I would like you to take that card and give it to them, or you can actually put it in the offering plate when we do that later, just to let us know you were here. I'll send you a letter saying that we're glad you're there and all that, but I'm not coming to your house or any of those types of things unless you request it on the back, and then I will. I want to thank some folks. Yesterday, we had our Easter egg hunt for our elementary age and younger kids, and we had a ton of people who were working it. And I really, who worked the thing, they weren't working it, like trying to pick people up. They were, that's the way my brain went. I was like, they weren't doing that. They actually made pancakes and sausage and, you know, helped kids find eggs and all that kind of thing. It really sounded wrong in my head when I said it. I also want to remind you guys, hopefully you got a postcard in the mail this week. They kind of talked a little bit about the Sunday service next week on our Easter Sunday. If you didn't, there are a couple reasons for that. Either you've never filled out a connection card, or you filled out you've moved, or maybe they typed in your name wrong in your address. So if you didn't get one this week, if you would, fill out that connection card again and make sure that we have your correct information, or maybe for the first time, fill that out just so we can get it to you. One of the things that I realized afterwards, because someone told me, is that it was a great postcard and it looked really good. It had some great information except for one very important thing, where we were actually meeting on the University of Rio Grande campus. So there's another postcard coming out this week anyway that had that on there, and it's actually going to have a map and all that. But we are meeting at the Berry Performing Arts Center over there on Rio Grande's campus. It's the auditorium. If you went this weekend to see River Valley's musical, that's where it was. If you've ever seen we did some concerts there a few years ago, and that's Performing Arts Center. I know they do a lot of other activities in that place. There have been some other musicals and different events there. That's where we are going to be. So there are going to be people out there waving, and there are going to be signs to help you get to the right parking spots and all that. But we are moving there because we want to ensure that we have plenty of space for Easter. And because we're making sure we have plenty of space, that gives you a perfect opportunity to invite some new folks. If you're worried about it getting a little bit too crowded here, which it has over the last few weeks or last few months a couple different times. We do have a Good Friday service. That information will be on the postcard. It will be at 7 o'clock here on Friday evening. So if you're wondering when our Good Friday service is, that's an easy one to remember. It's on Friday at 7. We're also having a sunrise service, which we do yearly. It's not normally necessarily a massively attended one, but we meet out here on the point at 6:30, and we actually have a short service as we watch the sunrise. And if you've never actually been here to a sunrise service, it's actually extremely beautiful sunrises that we get out here on this hill. I mean, it's actually really amazing every year. Between the Good Friday service and the sunrise service, we are actually going to do this other thing that we've done for the last 3 years, we're going to do it again, called a watch fire. As you leave sunrise at sunset on Good Friday, there will be a fire burning out on the point. And it will be maintained by different guys from the church throughout the entire weekend as a symbol of our expectation of Christ's resurrection. It's very symbolic and metaphorical and all that kind of stuff, but also it's a really good time. The guys come and hang out. My boys love coming and doing it. We camp, eat, and talk, and usually one time Steve, they thought Steve died because it was cold and he was watching the fire and he passed out and there was like, it got really cold, so he actually had the frost on his beard. And so we had a guy who was actually concerned that he had passed during the watch fire. Obviously he hadn't, but it's a good time. We just really, if you want to be part of that, that would be great. You can come in, you can stay the night, you can just hang out, you can come in during the day, or stay Saturday evening. I'll be there. I'm usually there on the Friday evening. I'm not there on Saturday evening because I have 3 services Sunday, so I won't be doing that. And then Easter, okay? So there's a lot going on. It'll be on that postcard. Like I said, if you didn't get the postcard and you want to make sure you do, give us your address, and I'll make sure you get that to us. It's very exciting. There's a lot of stuff going on, and it is it's an important day. It's a vital day and a celebration of the resurrection of Christ. So over the last few weeks, we have been looking, and that was a lot longer, and as a lot of you know, I don't like announcements, but there's just so much going on. As you know, we've been talking about this idea of heart, making our passion, taking the passion that Christ has given us into our community and around the world. And so we've talked about identifying our mission, trusting God to step out, knowing that it's not on us, it's not on our power that we're doing these things, that God is calling us to do that. And then last week, we really focused on this idea of compassion, allowing God to move us, not just be sad about the state of what's going on, but to move us into action. And one of the focuses, a focus that we've been talking about is it's not always large scale, right? We're not always going massive world-changing levels. In many cases, it's those small steps, those small moves that we have to make. Someone around us and feeling that we can make a difference in doing something about it. And so we've been focusing on all that, and this week we've been having a kind of a word we're focusing on. This week the focus is on the word conviction. Now, if you've grown up in different churches, and the word conviction means a few different things. Sometimes it means that you feel like the recognition that you are a sinner in need of a Savior, and that's one element of it. There's the idea that there's a belief that there are certain things you do and don't do, which are also convictions. But a lot of times people talk about conviction as just a belief. Even when you look at a definition, it says it's a very strong belief. But there is more to a conviction than just a strong belief. Okay? If you go on social media or you watch television or whatever, there are a lot of people who will tell you what they believe strongly. But a conviction goes beyond that. It actually affects the behavior. It affects your lifestyle. It affects the things you do. And now, when I think about the idea of conviction, I have mixed emotions, okay? Because I've seen that misused in different ways. I've seen it misunderstood, partly because anybody who gets a little bit too passionate about things has a tendency to freak me out just a little bit. I start being kind of like the rest of you, and I get a little cynical when someone just kind of gets that eyes glazed over look when they start talking about what they believe and how it should, you know, really change the way you live. And it's partly because of, like I said, just things I've seen. Also a little bit probably about a little bit of concern about what people will think if I get too passionate about a certain thing. But my issue with conviction is more on the matter of execution, not so much on the fact that people, that I don't think it's an important thing. It's more focused on the fact that the way people say things and often look differently than what they say, that's where the problem is. And I'm not the only one. We all know the idea of conviction, and we think about it. We don't like people who lack conviction. I mean, how many times have you have trouble voting for a person, or you had trouble getting behind a person who was your leader or whatever. Or I was even thinking this week about when I was teaching, you would have other teachers go to trainings that they didn't want to go to trainings, but they went to the training, and then their job was to come back and then train you. And then they would come back and they'd be like, okay, so here's what they said. Apparently, now we're supposed to track this thing. And this is the way they told us that we're supposed to do it, so we should probably do that or we'll get fired. Okay, that was the response. And those of you who aren't teachers, you've seen that in other situations. And when you see that, you get frustrated. You're like, well, that they don't. Why would I get behind it? They don't even believe what they're saying. Or people who lack it and they try to fake it. Like they're really excited about something, and we have problems with that. But then we mistrust people who seem like they have too much. We start using words like fanatic or lunatic, or we focus on the intensity of it, and we just get a little bit bogged down by it. But we struggle with this idea of living with conviction. And it pours over into our faith, because on one hand, we don't want to look like, we don't want people to think we're fake, so we don't act like we have conviction about something, because we don't be fake. But we don't want to actually adopt true conviction about things, because we don't want to be labeled crazy, right? And it affects that thing, and it impacts our openness to faith and our willingness to share what it is. But if we are truly going to take our passion and see it change our lives, and see it change the lives of the people around us and change the world, we are going to have to realize that the convictions that we hold define us. They define who we are. Over the last 3 weeks, I've used this line that I stole from Bill Hybels, and I say I stole it. I don't know if that makes it better, but I stole it. It's this belief that is kind of foundational to who we are, or who I want us to be, who I believe we are called to be. Every single person we know would be better off with Jesus Christ at the center of their lives. That's the conviction I hope we begin to live by, that I want to live by. Every single person. And when we begin to allow that to be the conviction, we have convictions about a lot of other things. We're very strong beliefs. We allow it to determine the colors we wear and the teams for whom we root and all of those other things. But if at the center of it, at the base, at the foundational level, we really allow this conviction of every single person is better off with Jesus Christ at the center of their lives, it will define everything. It changes everything about us. And I think it's probably why it's really scary. Because it'll push us to look at life differently. It pushes us to look at people differently. It pushes us to behave differently. It's tough. So today, we've been highlighting a few different groups. Some local things that are going on and some world things that are going on. And today, I have been increasingly, there's a group called God's Hands at Work that you're gonna see a video about in just a second. I have been impressed with them over the last year or so to see, and even though I've dealt with them on some different levels, we've got some folks here who actually volunteer out there with them in Vinton a few times throughout the month. But what I've been impressed with is the conviction that they believe that people who care, who are moved by the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the message, the good news of Christ, can make a difference in their community. And they're doing it in tons of different ways. And so what I want you guys to do for the next 5 minutes, I just want you to watch this video about the organization called God's Hands at Work. And as you're doing this, and you're listening to all the things they're doing, allow this idea of every single person connected with what they're doing, and maybe ask God where you two can fit into this opportunity to serve the people of our community.
My name is Lisa Carroll, and I'm one of the founders and the president of God's Hands at Work. God's Hands at Work is a 501c3 nonprofit organization, and we serve Gallia, Jackson, Mason, Meigs, and Vinton counties. Our mission is to help folks in our community when we see a need, when they need a hand up out of a temporary situation, and show them God's love. And we're commanded to love our neighbors as ourselves, and so that's what we're trying to do here at God's Hands at Work. God's Hands at Work started in my business, which was the Treasure Cove, and using the store's back room, the stock room, we just acted as a drop-off location there. We saw a need in the community when we had a couple fires. There were actually three fires in a 24-hour period, and we acted as a drop-off location for folks to bring donations of clothing and that kind of stuff, and the community really seemed to get behind the idea of helping their neighbors, and it's something that I had felt drawn to do for a long time, to have a nonprofit, didn't have the manpower or the funding to do that. And while the community was behind it, some other folks came forward and said they'd like to help with that as well. So we organized and became a 501c3. We got this building because we had started a building fund drive. We decided, you know, we've got to have a place. Seems to be the direction that the Lord is leading us, and we know He's able to provide, so we're just going to step out on faith and we're going to start a building fund drive. We announced that at our Basket Bingo fundraiser, and that is our biggest fundraiser of the year, so there were quite a few people there. And during that bingo, we explained about kicking off the fundraising drive for a building and what we had envisioned that we'd like to have: a room for clothing and a room for food and a room to have meetings and a place to have community dinners. And we named all those things. And there was a lady there at bingo that day. That was on a Saturday. Sunday morning, she called me and she said, "Lisa, I have exactly what you said you need." And I said, "What?" And she said, "I've got exactly what you said you need. Our church closed last week. We held our last service last Sunday, and it's got everything you need. All the rooms you said you need, all the space, it's got a kitchen, everything you said you're in need of, it's there. And there's no one else to ask. If you'd like to see it at 2:30 today, it's yours if you need it." They said they felt like God wasn't done with this building. And when everyone else was voting to close it, her husband, Howard, was a deacon and said, "God's not done." And he was right. It's still a church. It's just a church in a different... What always comes to me is a church without walls. It's about loving your neighbor as yourself. And anyone who loves their neighbor as themselves is welcome here. You don't have to be a part of any one church. We have a room where we keep furniture. We also have household items, kitchen items in that room. So when folks are maybe been burned out of their home, starting over for whatever reason, coming out of prison sometimes, coming out of rehab, coming out of Serenity House, and they just need everything from the decor to the dishes and everything in between. That room can furnish a home pretty much. Then we have rooms where they can get clothing, rooms where they can get food, personal hygiene items, diapers for babies, baby food, formula, that kind of stuff. Shoes, purses. Then we have a room with toys for the children, baby furniture for young moms just starting out. When there's a person in need, they come in during our regular hours and fill out an application for assistance. It's just a short application with their name, address, phone number, things like that, and then what their need is and why. If they're approved, they can get the clothing and food and personal hygiene, the household items right there on the spot. After we've assessed the client's application, we also make referrals with about 20 other agencies right now. And after we assess their situation, we look at, is there another agency who's already providing their need? If there is, we want to make a referral there so that they can get the most help that they need. We also take referrals from those other agencies as well. We have a lot of our clients do come back sometimes, and whether it's in the form of donating clothing back or donating food when they see we're having a drive, or sometimes they've even brought money back if we've paid an electric bill for them. When I was younger, I always felt that I might be called to the mission field, and that scared me. I was thinking mission field as in overseas somewhere, and I thought, Lord, are you sure you got the right person? Are you sure I can do that? There was a time when I asked him to use me. I remember just a simple, what I felt like was a simple prayer at the time. Lord, just use me however you see fit. Bring somebody to me today that I can witness to about you, and someone that I can help with whatever need they have, and show them your love. And I tease now that you should probably be careful what you ask for and be ready, you know, be really ready. Know that you're ready for that, because when you say that with a whole heart, with your whole heart, and with an open heart and an open mind, I believe he can use that. It wasn't 2 weeks later that I heard of these three fires on a Sunday morning. The fires had happened on Saturday, and Sunday morning when I got up and Facebook was just covered with, you know, prayer requests and they need these sizes and that. And I kind of chuckled to myself and said, okay, I get it. This is a way that I can help, you know. I always tell people now that no one person can do it all, but everyone can do something. And I feel like there's a little, I call it the still small voice, that we can hear if we just listen, just stop long enough and slow down long enough and listen. Then we can hear that voice, and he gives us little things to do. And when everybody's doing a little bit of something, then it becomes this thing bigger than us.
What's it look like to have that kind of conviction? When I think of that, I think of one of my favorite stories from when I was a kid. And we've got the scripture. We're going to read it in just a second. But it's about a guy named David. He was a shepherd. He was not particularly important in his family. He was the youngest. I have a feeling he was probably a bit of a show-off, maybe a little bit of a loud mouth at times. If you read the scripture, you'll see why I say that. But he was tending his flock, and he found out, his dad sent him to go take some food to his brothers who were in the army, and he went there, and they found out that there was a giant named Goliath. And every day the giant would come out, and he would challenge the other side. He would challenge the Israelites, and he would say, you know, send one of your guys out to fight me, and whoever wins, that side will become the master of the other side. And there are descriptions of how large Goliath was, you know, some even in the 9-foot range. A large, well-seasoned soldier who came out every day and challenged, and not one person in the army of Israel would respond. They actually sat in fear. So David says, I'm going to go. I'm going to go kill what? And he's actually flabbergasted. He's actually blown away that the entire army of the nation of Israel, who says they follow the one true creator God, who not only created the universe, but brought their people out of bondage in Egypt and carried them through the wilderness and all of these amazing stories that you can read in Genesis and Exodus and all this stuff. He's amazed that people who have that as their heritage are afraid of one guy. So here's his response. That he starts talking he's confident in his abilities, I guess is the best way to say it. and says, I'm going to fight this guy. And so they take him to the king, King Saul. And here's what he says to Saul. We're going to start in verse 32. We're only going to read 5 verses today. I know that's kind of rare for me. I usually like to read the entire chapter, it seems like. But here's what he says. "Don't worry about this Philistine," David told Saul. "I'll go fight him." "Don't be ridiculous," Saul replied. "There's no way you can fight this Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth." But David persisted. "I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats," he said. "When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and club it to death. I've done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine." Now, in my version, there's an exclamation point at the end of that, which I think is legit. Now, the rest of the story is he goes out with a sling and actually doesn't kill. This is something that some people don't know because they don't necessarily read. He doesn't kill Goliath with the sling. He knocks him down, and he cuts his head off. That's how he kills him. That usually does it. All right. But he does this, and that's the great story. And like I said, when I was a kid, I actually remember I had one of those like little golden book type things that told the story, and I read it all the time, looked at it. It was an amazing thing. But what's amazing to me, or what we can take from this, and I've heard many messages talked about, discuss this idea, and usually it's about faith and all those other things, and it's all wrapped up into this. But it's about his faith in God, but it's also about the conviction he had that his life was not his own, that it was in God's hands, and that if he allowed his conviction to guide him, God would take care of him. And he didn't know if he was going to, he had the confidence, he had the conviction that he was going to live. And you look at that, and when we talk about this idea of being mistrustful of people, this is fanatic level conviction. A kid who watches sheep for a living, going to go fight a giant super soldier. But his conviction led him into battle. He was willing to die because he knew he wouldn't. That's a conviction level that I can only hope to aspire to. Everything he said he believed, everything that he had experienced in looking at the goodness of God, affected the way he performed his life. It affected his activities. It affected not just all of those things, but it affected his willingness to step out when it looked like things were insurmountable. It's easy for us. I was actually teaching an Old Testament class for Ohio Christian University a few times a year, and I was teaching it this week, and we were discussing this idea of faith. And we're discussing this idea of God working, and the idea that when we are reading the Bible, sometimes we feel like all this stuff that's in there is for these people because they were somehow special. Somehow they were different from the rest of us. That this level of conviction, this level of being used was for them for a specific time so we would learn about what it meant to follow Christ, and so also it would make really good lessons for Sunday school classes. But this conviction with which David lived was not just for the faith superheroes. If you know anything about the story of David, David messed up many times. He was not a perfect person by any stretch of the imagination. As you look deeper into the lives of those biblical superheroes, they are broken, imperfect. Sometimes, before they get connected to God, detestable people. But they become connected. They develop a belief that turns into trust, that turns into conviction, and it changes the way they live, and it's for all of us. I've got a guy coming up now. Craig's coming up with another guy. His name's Joey Myatt. Usually his wife, Melissa, also comes, but she's actually, well, he can explain what Melissa's doing right now. We've been supporting them for this is our third year of supporting them as missionaries. Originally, when we were talking to them, they were talking about being missionaries to Guyana. He's going to kind of explain all that kind of stuff. But what's interesting about this is we don't get to see Joey very often. We see him a little bit more than some of our other missionaries. But when we talk, he is somebody that God has changed. And he can give you a little bit of his testimony. He's done that before. But because of what God has done in his life and the call that he has on his life, he lives with conviction. And so I'm not going to get too much into that because he and Craig spent some time yesterday together. And I just want you guys to listen to kind of what God's doing in their lives. And again, ask some questions about yourself. Have God open your heart up to how God can help you to live a life of conviction, not just belief, but allow those convictions, beliefs to define you as a person. So this is Joey, and this is Craig. Everybody knows Craig.
Good morning, FOF. How's everybody doing so far? All right. Well, as Jamie said, Joey Maya is here, and we are really excited just for an opportunity to spend some time with him this morning. Yesterday morning, I guess, during the Easter egg hunt, Jamie and Joey and I snuck into Pastor Jamie's office as the kids were running around chasing eggs and got to spend some quality time. And the passion that he shared with me, he told me he was a very direct, very quick answering kind of guy, but the passion that he shared in the room there, I hope that comes out today a little bit. So Joey, first and foremost, why don't you tell us a little bit about how long you were in Guyana, what your family's doing now, just kind of catch us up a little bit.
Okay. Well, we were in Guyana for a little under a year when we actually moved there. We had started going there, gosh, almost 4 years ago now. And we went there for a couple months. And God just really captured our heart for the country of Guyana. Just precious, precious people. And then when we moved there for a year, we got involved with the local church, which was really encouraging for me because it kind of shifted my whole mindset because I'd been working in the church for almost probably 10 years. And, you know, I was very good at doing church. I was very good at, you know, this is our program. This is the songs we're going to sing. This is exactly what we're going to preach on. Don't go longer than 20 minutes. We're going to do an altar call every time, and then we're going to go have some food with the people of the church. And I got to Guyana, and I started going to church there, and it was funny but sad because it was even more legalistic than that. I honestly heard them turning on their sound system when they would start church, and they actually did sound checks exactly the same everywhere in the country. Every church would do the exact same sound check, the exact same prayers. They were pretty much just cookie-cutter pastors and cookie-cutter churches. And it really hurt my heart because it's just like God's a God who loves individuals. And he doesn't call robots. He calls people. He calls broken people like us to do wonderful things. And so it's like, wow. So God put on my heart to really almost be a missionary to the church of Guyana. And then my daughter got an ear infection, and so we had to move home because she can't fly anymore. And I started attending churches in the United States, and God kind of unveiled some things and said, you know, what you saw in Guyana happens in this church too. It's kind of funny how it's kingdoms like that. So now our focus is we actually are ministering to local churches, local pastors, and we're actually starting a whole new training program that will actually train people how to interact with their church. Because as YWAM, which we're Youth with a Mission, and I'm sure I'll explain that in a second, but we're really good at training people. We're really good at teaching people who they are in Christ. We're really good at teaching them how to tell people about Christ. We're really good at teaching them to be a missionary. We're not really good at getting them to come home and serve in their local church. And so God's really laid it upon my heart to do that. So that's my fanatical thing. So if you want to see me get fanatical, I'll talk to you about the church.
Well, you did mention YWAM, which is a lot of fun to say. Why don't you tell us what that is, and then tell us why you got involved in that organization?
All right. YWAM is actually the initials for Youth with a Mission. It is either the largest or the second largest missionary organization in the world. It's interdenominational. We work with every single church. We work with Baptists all the way to Catholics. If they love Jesus, we work with them. We have over 1,600 locations throughout the world. There's 450 training bases. We actually have bases in every country you're allowed to and a couple that you're not. The reason I got involved with them is when I was a youth pastor in Jacksonville, I would invite them to come and do youth programs at my church. And just the passion that they did things with and just seeing the excitement to serve the Lord, it was really refreshing to me as a youth pastor. And then as things were happening after I got ordained, the Lord just started dealing with me and my wife, and he was showing us that it was time to move on. And I honestly thought I was going to be a pastor or a youth pastor somewhere. I actually called a pastor here in Ohio and was applying for a youth pastor job. And the actual email he sent me back was, "You live in Florida. Why in God's name would you move to Ohio?"
Amen.
I saw wisdom
Amen.
In that. So God just lined some things up, and YWAM came back into my life, and we decided we'd do a DTS, which is the discipleship training program. And yeah, God just captured me and my wife, and this is our life now.
Excellent. Well, I love how, you know, usually as an interviewer, I lead you into questions, but you're leading me, which I love. I mean, that's a lot of fun. So tell us a little bit, this DTS, even yesterday when we were talking about that, you looked at me like, you should know what a DTS is, Craig. So
yeah.
So tell me a little bit about what that stands for,
right.
And then why is it so important for you to be a part of this? What has God, that conviction that Jamie was talking about, what has he laid on your heart? Talk about that a little bit.
What a discipleship program, or DTS is a discipleship training program. It's an entry-level school to get into YWAM. Every YWAMer has to do it. You go through 3 months of classroom lecture phase, and we teach everything from the Father Heart of God to sonship. We also do apologetics and everything else. And then after that 3 months, we do a two-month mission trip so people can actually practically do what they've learned for the last 3 months. The reason it's so near and dear to my heart is because I've always been brought up that if you see a problem and you don't do anything about it, you're part of the problem. And so the conviction in my heart is in going around from church to church raising money, we have found that there was a disconnect between the church and missionaries. Yeah, churches support missionaries, which is amazing, but a lot of times they do it maybe begrudgingly or not really with a fervent heart. They do it because they're supposed to. And a lot of missionaries, sadly, they go to the churches to get money, but they don't agree with what the church is doing, and they talk about everything that's wrong with the church. So it's almost like a divorce, and the missionary is going to get their alimony payment so they can do what they need to do. And that's just sad because it's one kingdom. We serve the risen Savior. We all do. And what I do is no more important than what a gym teacher does when he's telling his students in school about Jesus. We're one kingdom. And so I just want to see that kingdom come back together. I want to see the church be hand-in-hand with missions. There not be a separate circles, but just be completely the kingdom of God. And so that's why it's really important for me to be part of this DTS. It's groundbreaking. YWAM has never done anything like this before. And when I talk to pastors about this DTS, they get excited because they see a need. When I talk to YWAM about it, they're like, "We don't train church people. We train missionaries." So it's just as much a missionary problem as it is a church problem. But the Holy Spirit's working, and God's opening up some doors.
Excellent. I know here at FOF, just at my time here with Jenny and I being here, that missions in general, when we first started attending, was not a big deal. And as you guys have seen over this past month, we are slowly but surely and excitingly, I feel like, doing a great job at doing exactly what Joey just talked about. Not the divorce part of it, the alimony check part of it, but we are starting to get to know the people around us and the missionaries around us and what we can do to help those missionaries. So let me ask you just that very question. What is it that we at FOF can do more of to help you?
Awesome. Well, before I answer that,
okay,
I do have to say, you guys have a special place in me and my wife's heart. You guys are actually the first church that supported us monthly.
Amen.
You supported us before my church supported us. So, so that's just one amazing thing. And so, yeah, me and my wife, she told me to make sure I said, thank you guys. You make it a whole lot easier to do a budget. But as far as what you can do to be involved, Pastor Jamie's going to come and actually do a teaching in the next DTS, which I want to thank you guys for releasing him to do that. But also just pray about who in your life you see a calling that God has on their life, but they don't know where. Send them to us. We're not that far away. We're a 7-hour drive, and we'll take them for those 5 months, and we'll just pour into their lives. We'll show them everything that God has showed us, and then we'll send them back to you, hopefully better equipped to serve you guys in the local church. And just pray for us. I mean,
What areas, like if we wanted to send somebody, or there's maybe even somebody on our heart that we're thinking about, what areas would that be in?
Every area of the church. And the reason I say it like that is because in the 12 weeks that we have them, we'll have 12 different speakers. Like when Jamie comes, Jamie's going to be teaching on the authority of the scripture. But then in the evenings, he's going to be teaching on public speaking. We're not going to have enough time to teach someone to be a youth pastor. But I will have enough time to teach people concepts on how to be a youth pastor. And to keep it from being like Joey-centered, because trust me, I'm a mess, we're inviting people who are doing it right to come and teach. Because, again, this is about the kingdom. So if I see a youth pastor that is an amazing youth pastor, why would I try to tell somebody else how to do what he does? My best bet is to say, hey, give me a week of your time. Come pour into these people's lives. And so we can start self-replicating good tendencies, because I'm bold enough to say I think we've been self-replicating some very bad tendencies as a Big C church. And so that's just what's on our heart. So anywhere between whether they're going to be long-term missionaries overseas or if they're going to be a layman youth pastor, I mean, anything that God's calling them in, that's what we want to do. We want to equip people to do the calling that God's put on their life.
Excellent. Well, church, why don't you bow your heads with me and let's pray with the mites a little bit. I know that that's one thing that he had talked about that is very important to him, so let's go ahead and do that. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for a Big C church, a church here in Rio Grande, Lord, that loves you and that loves others, who have a conviction to see not just our place here in Rio grow, both numerically and growth spiritually, Lord, but to help those around us continually see you. We do that through a lot of different ways, but right here in front of us, Lord, we have the Mayans, and I just pray that you would just be with them, that you would give them the strength every morning to get up and have that passion renewed in them, to have that conviction to continually follow you, to continually put your heart in front of people, Lord. I love what Joey talked about today and what he talked about even yesterday some, Lord, just about connecting the dots of what the church sees a missionary and how they look and how a missionary sees the church. And when that relationship heals and we are able to come together, Lord, I'm very excited to see what that product looks like, Lord. I just thank you again for the Mayans. Everything that they do as a church, as a part of our church family, Lord. And I just pray that there would be people here today that would hear the message that he delivered, Lord, and that maybe would want to not just travel to Florida because it's nice, Lord, but travel because God has laid something upon their heart. It's your awesome name that we pray. Amen. Well, Joey, thank you. Yes.
Full disclosure, we're not in Florida. We're in Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania. Never mind.
Not near.
See,
me.
I was ready to go. I was ready. I mean, Florida, I son. Hey, give a hand to Joey as he leaves.
Thanks, guys. Well, it's very exciting. Actually, the story of how we got connected is pretty interesting too, to the Mayans. It's one of the few times in my life where a cold call actually resulted in something positive. Melissa was actually in Jackson. That's his wife's name. He didn't really ever say that. He kept saying my wife. Melissa is from Jackson, and she called one time, left a message on the machine, and we got a chance to get together, and it was really, we knew that there was some connection as far as understanding the mission that God has for them and has for us. So as we're finishing today, we think about what's happened with God's hands at work, and we're discussing that. We look at what the Myatts were doing and are doing, continue to do. And it's interesting with Joey in their conversations. There was even a little bit when we start talking about that mindset of being concerned. They were a little concerned when they decided that their focus was going to shift, that they were no longer supposed to be in Guyana all the time, that they were supposed to be training more people, not only to work in foreign missions, but in the local church. We had that conversation, and they were a little concerned. And my response was extremely the opposite of what he was expecting. I was very excited, because the idea of people going out and being trained and then coming back and being able to feed in and not just doing youth pastoring, but to understanding the importance of all those other elements of ministry is really exciting to me. And actually, our nation, is extremely important to have more people understand the need for ministry, the need for ministering here. There are a lot of churches without pastors. There are a lot of classrooms without Sunday school teachers. There are a lot of youth groups who are struggling to get along. There are just a lot of different places, and we can be a part of training them. So I'm excited about that. I have one confession to make before we finish up today. I think I've talked to him about it. Craig and I joke about it a lot. When missionaries come, they initially usually say the most important thing you can do for us is pray, but they really want us to write checks. And that's bad. And like I said, Craig has a missions degree, and we've got other friends who are missionaries. But that's growing up. I remember they would always say the most important thing you can do is pray. Here's how you can support us monthly. And there's a reason for that. They need that kind of support. But in my mind, the cynical thing that I talked about earlier, my struggle is that I don't always believe that the most important thing that I can do for them is pray. I don't necessarily live a life of conviction that prayer is the most important thing that we can do for our loved ones. This is something that is not part of what my plan was. It was just honestly, as I was prepping this morning and as I was listening to what he was saying, that other type of conviction hit me. A few weeks ago, Ann Barrett posted on Facebook asking for people to come and partner with her to pray, because we're making some shifts and changes in the way that we do things here at Fellowship of Faith, with the way we handle our finances and the way we handle ministry. And she had a few responses, and part of that is because I don't necessarily believe that Facebook's the way that works. But we have a few responses of people who said, yeah, I'll be doing that. And a lot of them were people who I already know pray for the church daily anyway. But I realized through that, and as I've talked the last couple of weeks, I asked you to pray for Easter Sunday. And it hit me this morning as I was actually working on the other postcard, having these conversations, that I have not spent nearly as much time praying for what God wants to do on Easter Sunday as I have been planning all the stuff that needs to happen on Easter Sunday. And I've realized that we as a church, and me being the lead guy, the point person, the lead pastor, we've got to develop a conviction that the first response to our situations is prayer. Because it's a cliche that prayer changes things, but the reality is the God to whom we pray changes things. Has the power to do that. That's not fanatical. That's not something that I've pulled out of context. It's a statement of fact and reality. Throughout Scripture, we see it. Throughout the history of God's people, it is the truth. So my commitment to you is to begin to live the conviction that prayer is step one in everything that I do. as we finish today and we think about all this other stuff, this idea of dealing with the idea of living a conviction, this idea of every single person is better off with Jesus Christ at the center of our life, I want to challenge you with a few things and we're done. I want you to realize that every single person starts with you. Every single person is better off with Christ at the center of their lives. You first. We've tried so often in our lives to try to do all, like I even just discussed, get things done and do programs and do find ministries and do all of those types of things. And so often the reason that they fail is because we who are doing them do not have Christ at the center of what we're doing. It's based on ego or frustration with other situations or anger at other churches or this or program that we learned or how we were discipled. Whatever it is ends up being the thing. But if you believe every single person is better off with Jesus at the center of their life, it begins with you. It has to be a non-negotiable. It has to be the thing on which you will live and die. When we were in New Orleans a couple years ago doing a mission trip, I was talking to, and I think I've told this story before, but I talked to the guy who was kind of our contractor. And he was asking about how we built houses in Ohio. And one of the things that he talked about that's different is their foundations are very different in New Orleans because they don't have bedrock. They're built under sea level, and everything is sand. And what they have to do in order to even get a foundation that's useful is they take these pylons and they drive them into the ground, hundreds of feet into the ground. And they build their houses on those because that's what gives them a foundation. We have to realize, you have to understand, I have to understand, in order for us to truly see the power of God released in our lives, we have to drive things down with conviction. The fact that Christ is the center of what we do, of everything we do. The fact that we can pray and go to Him and He will listen to us. And then we don't always get the right answer. It doesn't mean that if you pray for an awesome car and house, it's going to happen, because it doesn't work that way and there's more to understand. To drive down the belief that Jesus Christ, who we're going to celebrate next Easter, His resurrection, that He came and lived a perfect life and He died for humanity, and anybody who believes in them can have eternal life. That has to be the conviction under which we live. That has to be part, one of those hundreds of feet deep things down into our soul. Because then we can change. We can start really truly believing and living with conviction that every single person is better off with Jesus Christ at the center of their lives. We have to own that truth. God lives in you. That's the truth. You are the light. Jesus said it, Matthew 5. You are the light of the world. Own it. Believe it. You are called to do something, to see lives change. You're called to go make disciples. Own it. And believe that if you do those things in God's name, in Christ's name, if you follow the calling, that it will be done. It will be finished. Not only will He continue to work in your life and see that work done, as like in Philippians, he says, you know, Paul's talking to the Philippian church and he says, you know, He who began a good work will see it through to completion. Own that He will change you. And that He wants to see other people's lives change through you. Own those things. They're not just cliches. They're not just things that I want to say to make you feel better or to challenge you or to get you to do stuff I don't want to do. It's the truth. And then live with those convictions. Drive them down. Live with them without apology, without fear, without going and you're trying to do it yourself without blaming all those other things, without concern about what other people are going to think if you get a little bit too fanatical about your faith. Live with that conviction. Walk into a battlefield facing a giant, knowing that you could die, but being confident that you won't, because of the one in whom you have placed your faith. My question today is, do you want to be the one who is defined by your conviction? You already are, but what will those convictions be? Elizabeth read the passage earlier. We talk about Palm Sunday, and if you've not grown up in church, it doesn't really have a lot of significance to you. But the story of Jesus entering Jerusalem on a donkey, and people standing on the sides, worshiping him, saying he's the king, worshiping him as the Messiah, laying down palm fronds, laying down their coats so he can, as a king, enter Jerusalem. They honestly believed it at the moment. And it had zero effect on their lives. Within 5 days, they're screaming for his death. Do you want to be defined by the convictions of who Christ is, what he has done, and what he will do? That's the question this morning. Or will you do the same thing as that crowd come in on Sundays, worship, get excited, maybe even do your personal Bible study every day, memorize scripture, sing only Christian music in your car? And all it does is make you feel a little bit better about yourself and doesn't affect anything else that you do. We can live with conviction. We can face giants with confidence. If we look at those situations and say, this is the God who delivered us, who delivered me. Stand with me, please.